Welcome back, everyone. We are going to continue our discussion from the last class, in which we saw basically we learned about Duhamel integral, and we also saw that how to obtain solution of a single degree of freedom system subject to any arbitrary excitation. Okay, now we are going to discuss some of the specific cases of pulse excitation as well as step forces, and then see whether how we can obtain the analytical response of a single degree of freedom system.
Last class we saw that if we have some arbitrary excitation, okay, so if we have the equation a single degree of freedom system, which is represented by, let us say, this differential equation, okay, and I'm not considering damping here for the time being, and if PT is some arbitrary excitation, okay, so we derived a integral which is called a convolution integral, okay, to find out the response to any arbitrary excitation P of T. And the idea behind that was that if I have, let us say, any random, okay, any arbitrary varying load or excitation PT, then the response at any time t, okay, to get this response, we divided this force into very small duration forces, okay, and we said that these forces, small duration forces, would basically represent a impulse, okay, so they would represent each of them an impulse, and the response at time t would be sum of responses due to each of impulses, okay, and as we know, the response due to an impulse is basically free vibration with initial velocity. How can we sum up all those responses up to time t to get the response ut at time t? So basically, we derived the expression first for Duhamel convolution integral, and we saw that we can substitute the value of unit impulse response function to get the Duhamel integral. Okay, so I'm just going to write the final expression. Okay, so for an undamped system, we got this expression. Okay, so we can utilize this expression to get the response. Okay, and similarly for damped system as well, we can write down the Duhamel integral. But now I would have omega t here in this. There would be a e to the power minus eta, this term here, times sine omega t minus tau d tau. Okay, and we discussed that in some cases Duhamel integral is very useful to get the response, okay, analytical response of function ut, something like this, okay, and in some cases you can use the conventional method of solving the differential equation, and it will purely depends on the problem. Okay, so we'll have to inspect the problem and look at the integrand that you have inside that integration to see which would be easier. Okay, so utilizing this, basically we obtain response to a step force, which is represented something like this. Okay, so force, sorry, there's no, okay, so this is a step force, okay, with suddenly applied load of magnitude P naught, and then it is maintained over time as P naught. Okay, and we found out the response to this, okay, as ut equal to ust naught, which was P naught by k times 1 minus cos omega nt. And then we found out what is the response due to a linearly increasing force, which, let's say this is Pt here and this is T, and let us say this force is represented by P naught T by Tr, where P naught is basically this amplitude which is achieved over time duration of Tr. Okay, so during the linearly increasing phase, we try to obtain the solution Ut as Ust naught, okay, times T by TR times sine omega n, okay, times T divided by omega n TR. So as you can see, it is vibrating at frequency omega n, around its static solution, which is represented by this here. So UST is represented by this P naught T by KTR, which is basically this function here. Okay, so this is, so we saw that TR by TN is a very important parameter here, and we are further going to discuss that today. Okay, so let us now discuss, so we stopped at this point, and let us now discuss what happens to the response during the constant force phase. Okay, so what we are going to do today is basically a step force, okay, with finite rise time. All right, and this is a better representation of force that is applied in real life. So if you think about it, it is almost impossible to apply a sudden force. There is always some duration, however small it may be, okay, over which this P naught or the amplitude of the force that is achieved. Okay, so in general, I can represent any force, okay, that reaches to its maximum value P naught through a step force with a finite rise time. Okay, and we can also call it a ramp force. Okay, so basically the problem statement that we have here is basically I'm applying a force which goes to its amplitude P naught over a time duration TR, okay, and then it is maintained at that value P naught. Okay, so if I want to find out the response to this step force, let us see how to do that. Okay, so our differential equation would be mu dot plus ku, that is equal to pt. Okay, and this is basically equal to p naught t by tr for t smaller than tr. Okay, so for this zone here, okay, I'm representing this function. Okay, all right. And for a constant force phase, of course, it would be P naught for T greater than TR. So for this, we have already obtained the solution. And let me write that again. Okay. I have obtained the solution as UST naught times T by TR minus sine omega n TR divided by omega n TR. Okay, and this is for T smaller than TR. Now let us obtain solution for the second part. Now if you look at it, okay, the second part we have something like this. Okay, and we know this is nothing but the differential equation for a step force that we had done previous to this step force with a finite rise time. So basically what I'm trying to do here, the total response at any time after the rise time TR would be, okay, I'm going to divide this force into two, so this and this here. Okay, so let us say, and this is P naught. Okay, so up to this point, my single degree of freedom system would have achieved some displacement and velocity. Okay, so if you represent this instead of pt, if you say that let us say this is ut, it would have achieved some ut here and some u dot. Okay, let us say not ut, but let us say this is utr and then u dot tr. Okay, and for a linear system, if I'm representing the total solution, okay, to this step function as a sum of solution to this linearly increasing phase up to time TR and then step force from point TR onwards, it would be basically with this initial condition, it would undergo free vibration, right? That we already know. However, note that the motion starts here at TR instead of T0. Okay, and in this case, we already know what is the solution for this one, isn't it? We know that, okay, for this step force, the solution is basically, okay, so this is step force and the solution I can write it as UST naught 1 minus cos omega nt. Okay, and again, remember that this is starting at t equal to tr. So this t I will have to shift to tr. Okay, so if I sum it up, basically what I have here, the total response can be represented as free vibration response due to linearly increasing phase. Okay, and because it is starting at t equal to tr and not t equal to 0, I am basically shifting it by tr so that my time, okay, variable is represented by now t minus tr. Okay, and this I will write it like that, sine omega n minus t minus tr. Okay, plus there's a constant force phase, okay, for which the response I can again write it as UST naught, okay, 1 minus cos omega n t minus tr. All right, now this is the free vibration phase response due to free vibration, and this is the constant force phase. Okay, so this is the response due to free vibration, this is the constant force phase. Now in this I can substitute the value of u of tr and u dot of tr by substituting t equal to tr in this expression first and then differentiating it and then again substituting t equal to tr. Okay, so I will do that. What I'm going to do here, just write the final expression. Okay, so that my u of t is equal to ust naught, okay, times 1 plus omega ntr times 1 minus cos omega ntr, okay, times sine omega n t minus tr, and then I have sine omega n tr times cos omega n t minus tr. Okay, so this is the expression that I have, and if you look at it, this is nothing, this is a constant here. Okay, you can call it A and this is another constant is B. Okay, and these are coefficients to sine omega n t minus tr and cos omega n minus tr. So this is basically something of form A cos theta and then B sine theta. Okay, and we will utilize this property later when we have to find out the maximum value of ut. Okay, but right now let us further simplify this so that my ut becomes ust naught and the terms that I have inside the bracket, okay, it reduces to omega ntr, and then I have these terms here, omega ntr minus cos omega t minus tr. Okay, all right, so if you look at it here, okay, the I can write down my ut divided by ust naught as this function that I have inside this one. Okay, sine omega n, and I can do maybe one more thing. Remember, omega n tr I can write it as 2 pi tr by tn. Okay, so let me substitute that here so that I get this one as, okay, tn divided by 2 pi tr, and then inside I would have the sine term 2 pi tr by tn. Okay, then this cos term here, which would be cos 2 pi t by t minus 2 pi tr by tn. Okay, all right, so if you look at this carefully, okay, my system is vibrating at frequency as frequency omega n or the time period Tn. Alright, so that is clear. It vibrates at its natural frequency. Okay, and my response actually depends on the value of Tr divided by Tn. Note that it does not individually depends on Tr or Tn. Okay, if you look at it, it is always in the ratio form anywhere in this expression here for ut divided by ust naught. Okay, so it depends on the ratio. So I might have different ratio of Tr by Tn, for example 1 divided by 2 or 2 divided by 4. As long as the ratio is still the same, I would get similar kind of dynamic response for my system. Okay, so that is an important point, that the response actually depends on the value of Tr, which is the rise time, divided by the time period of the system. Okay, so that need to be kept in mind. Okay, so if we want to plot this for different value of Tr by Tn, okay, I will have, okay, the response of the system. Okay, so let me just copy that and then show you how does it look like. Okay, so if you look at carefully here, okay, so what these plots basically represent the ratio of the dynamic displacement versus peak static displacement. Okay, and these have been plotted for different values of Tr by Tn. Okay, and the horizontal axis is basically the normalized time. Okay, so if you look at it, when my Tr is very small like this, okay, in this case, note that there are two lines here. The dotted line is actually, it is static displacement, which is nothing but u static of time variation of the static displacement as pt divided by k. Okay, so this is the static displacement, assuming my system does not have any mass, so that I can write it as this, and which for this case, like, you know, is simply this dotted line that has been shown here. Okay, the dynamic displacement is basically shown here using the solid line. Okay, so the solid line is my dynamic displacement. Now let us start with the smallest value of Tr by Tn. Okay, so let me draw a representation of this one. When Tr by Tn is something like this, okay, it is starting from zero, but the rise time is very small. Okay, the response that I see, it is similar to a step force, and that should be obvious considering, okay, for very small value of Tr by Tn, okay, the force actually resembles a step force. So this is P naught by K displacement, and then my system basically vibrates around the static equilibrium position, which is around the point P naught by K. Okay, so I can see here that my solution or my system actually vibrates around the static equilibrium position. Okay, and the vibration, the amplitude, the amplification, or let us say difference between the dynamic and the static, it's quite large. Okay, now as I increase that, as I go from Tr by Tn to this value that I have here, okay, so as I go from Tr by Tn to Tr by Tn equal to 0.5, I see that there is still a lot of vibration. So there is still, like, you know, significant difference between static and dynamic. However, in this case, that difference has actually been reduced, okay, compared to Tr by Tn equal to 0.2. So as I increase my, okay, as I increase the rise time, okay, the difference between the static displacement and the dynamic peak displacement actually reduces. Okay, and that is further enforced by the fact when you look at Tr by Tn equal to response for Tr by Tn equal to 1.5, and then further response for Tr by Tn equal to 2.5. Okay, for the value very large like Tr by Tn equal to 2.5, you can see the dynamic solution almost trailing the static solution. So it is almost like, you know, close to, very close to the static solution. So that means if I have rise time, which is, okay, which is very, very large, okay, which is very, very large, then my dynamic solution is almost close to the static solution, and I don't see much difference, or I don't see much amplification of the response. Okay, so in this case, depending upon the TR by TN, okay, the dynamic characteristic of the response is determined. So TR by TN is a very important parameter to characterize the response to a step force with finite rise time. Okay, there are two additional cases when TR by TN is equal to 1 and when TR by TN is equal to 2. Or for a matter of case, whenever you will have TR by TN equal to N, okay, where N is equal to 1, 2, 3, so on, integer value, what you will see, okay, at the end of the linearly increasing phase, you do not get any oscillation, okay, so no vibration during the constant force phase. Okay, and why that happens is actually, when you have this condition, your velocity actually is equal to zero at time t equal to tr. Okay, so for that case, if the velocity is equal to zero, basically if you substitute in the expression for ut, you will get ut as equal to ust naught, okay, which would be constant and not vibrating with time. And if you want to imagine this physically, think it like the equilibrium position under the action of load P naught is actually at a displacement P naught by K. So if you apply a static load of P naught, the equilibrium position is P naught by K. And let us say I have a spring which is, okay, vibrating around this P naught by K. Now when it comes to this displacement P naught by K, and if your velocity is zero, then what do you think will happen? Remember, in previous instances of free vibration, okay, when you had system undergoing through the equilibrium position, it had the maximum velocity and zero displacement measured from the equilibrium position. So if I measure the displacement from the equilibrium position, when it crosses here, it will have zero displacement and it would be in equilibrium because that is the equilibrium under the load P naught. So if it's in equilibrium and there is no velocity there, then there is nothing that would take the system beyond this and then bring it back here. Okay, so, and that happens for very specific case when TR by TN is equal to any integer. Okay, so for those cases, when the system passes through equilibrium, basically it has zero velocity and then there is nothing that would take the system further on to continue the vibration. Okay, so that's why for these cases you get this kind of response, no vibration during the constant force phase. Okay, all right, if this is clear, now let us look at, if you remember, for a harmonic excitation, okay, we had defined a function RD which we said is the ratio of maximum peak dynamic displacement divided by the peak static displacement. Okay, and that was a function of omega by omega n, and this was for the harmonic case. Now I want to do something similar for a step force with finite rise time or for the ramp load. Okay, however, there is no frequency here, there is no excitation frequency in this case. Okay, so let us see what do we get, okay, as the value of u net by ust naught. Okay, and then we will try to go more into the expression. Okay, so if you remember, my ut, okay, I wrote down an expression for ut which was ust naught, okay, times 1 plus 1 divided by omega tr, and then there was this term here, 1 minus cos omega n tr times sine omega n t minus tr, and then there was this term here, omega n tr, okay, times cos omega n t minus tr. Okay, now if you look at it, as I previously stated, this is a constant and this is also a constant, only this and this Okay, sine and cos functions are basically functions of time. So you can say this is A and this is B and this is as sine theta and let us say this is cos theta. Okay, so this is something like this, AX sine theta minus cos theta. And again, this is also a constant. So maximum value of the dynamic displacement basically depends on the maximum value of this expression here. And as we know, if we have a function of the type A sine theta minus or plus cos B cos theta, the maximum value is always A square plus B square. Okay, because I have this term sine theta minus phi, whatever I can write it, and the maximum value is actually A square plus B square under root. Okay, so I'm going to do that. Okay, I'm substitute it here. Okay, and when I simplify this, I will find out that my U naught by UST naught is actually this expression here. Okay, I can just, I'm just going to write the final expression. Okay, so this is phi, sorry, this is TR here, phi TR divided by TN, and this divided by phi TR by TN. So again, if you look at carefully, and let us say this is my RD now, okay, this depends on the value of TR by TN. So like for a harmonic excitation of a single degree of freedom system, the parameter on which the response modification factor, okay, depends on is omega by omega n. For a ramp loading, that parameter is TR by TN. Okay, and I can go ahead, okay, I can go ahead and plot this function, okay, RD, okay, function as a value, as a function of basically TR by TN. So for different values of TR by TN, I'm going to basically plot this function. Okay, now I can do that mathematically, or before doing that mathematically, let us see for extreme cases what happens. I have already told you when TR by TN is very, very small. Okay, it's very, very small. Okay, for those cases, this is almost like a step function. Okay, this is a suddenly applied force. Okay, suddenly applied force. Okay, and for suddenly applied force, we saw that my UT was approximately 2 times UST naught. Okay, that means RD was actually equal to 2. And that we saw that from this graph. Okay, if you look at it, it was almost close to 2. RD here was almost close to 2 here. Okay. So this is one extreme case. Other extreme cases when TR is much, much greater than 1. Okay. So this is, this would be like a slowly applied force. Okay. So for slowly applied force, we saw that UT was almost same as the static displacement. So the peak, basically the, sorry, this should be here U naught, not UT. Okay, and here also this should be U naught. So U naught is almost equal to UST naught. Okay, because my dynamic displacement was actually, okay, very much comparable to the static displacement throughout the time. So RD is actually equal to 1. Okay, so for these two extreme cases, we know that for very small value of TR by TL, but for very large value of TR by TL, what is the value of RT? Okay, now we also said that if TR by TN, okay, equal to some integer, okay, then for those cases, there is no vibration due to constant, during the constant force phase. Okay, and if there is no vibration, it means that static and dynamic are basically same. So again, for those cases as well, U naught, the peak dynamic displacement is actually equal to peak static displacement. So RD is again equal to 1. Okay. So we, utilizing these three cases, situations or scenarios, let us see if we are able to plot RD versus TR by TN. Okay. All right. So we have, let us say, we have said that We have said that when TR by TN is very small, the value is actually 2. So it is somewhere around here. When it is very large, okay, then it is close to 1. And we have also said that it is equal to 1 at integer value of TR by TN. So let us say this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4, and so on. So basically the actual response looks like something like this. Okay, with this decreasing with time. Okay. Alright, so depending upon the value of TR by TN, okay, we can calculate RD, and the same thing can also be obtained using, you know, the expression for RD. Okay, but we have just tried to obtain this using the analytical or discussion that we just presented. Now, a point here to note that how much would be the RD, how much different it would be from the static displacement. If this is 1, let us say this is 2, this is basically static. It depends on the value of TR by TN. Okay, and remember, these TR by TN decides, okay, whether it is going to be a suddenly applied force or whether it is going to be a slowly applied force. Okay, so whether it would have dynamic effect or whether it would be almost same as static and it would behave like a static. Okay, now this is a very important parameter, because most of the loads, when it is said that the load that is being applied is, let us say, 10 kilonewton. Okay, before this course, you did not care about knowing how the load was applied. So what was the time variation of the load? And if somebody says to you that something is applied slowly, it does not simply mean that it takes long time to actually apply that load. You also need to know, okay, whether the time, how long is that time with respect to the time period of the system. Okay, so that is an important parameter. So I'll give you an example. Okay, so whether something is slowly applied or whether it is a static force, okay, and whether a load is, like, you know, where suddenly applied, and whether it is a dynamic, it depends on this overall ratio. Okay, so let us say I have two bridges. One bridge is basically a rope bridge, okay, which is very flexible, and the second one I have is actually a concrete bridge. Okay, now let us say for the rope bridge, my frequency is around 2 seconds, time period is around 2 seconds, and for concrete bridge, let us say it is around 0.1 second. Okay, which is typical, you know, because it is very flexible, the rope bridge, it would have, okay, very large time period compared to concrete bridge, which has a very small time period of 0.1 second. Now, whether something is slowly applied or whether it is, suddenly applied depends on this ratio. So let us say I want to apply a load. Okay, so that the dynamic effect is very, very less. Okay, so let us say I can do that for, let us say, TR by TN. If this ratio is very, very high, okay, then I can say that there is no dynamic amplification. Okay, my RED would be equal to 1. Okay, so it would behave like static. Now, to achieve the static type condition, okay, in this case, the rise time has to be 2 times 10, 20 seconds. And in this case, the rise time could be just 2 seconds. Alright, so if you see that here, okay, for this rope, because it is very flexible, you need to be applying the load at a much, much slower pace or over a very large duration of time to achieve similar kind of response, okay, compared to concrete bridge, in which you can apply the load much quickly and still be able to obtain similar kind of response. Okay, and, like, you know, you can observe this realistically as well. If you jump on a rope bridge, it will start oscillating, so you will see much more dynamic effect. Okay, so remember, you are applying similar kind of load over a similar duration. Okay, So if you jump on a rope bridge or if you jump on a concrete bridge, you are applying similar load over a similar duration. However, because the time period of the two bridges are different, you would see basically different response. Okay, so keep that in mind, that whether something is static or dynamic, okay, it depends on the ratio TR by TN, and slow, whether something is applied slowly or suddenly, okay, it is not only a function of time. Okay, time is relative, it is actually depends on, in a structural dynamics, whether something is slow or fast, it depends on the ratio of the duration with respect to the time period of the system. Okay, so this is something that you need to keep in mind, TR by TN, which is a very important parameter. All right, so with this we saw that how to get the response of a system subject to a ramp loading or basically a step force with a finite rise time. Okay, now what we are going to discuss, a different type of excitation, which is basically called pulse excitations. Okay, so we are going to get into pulse excitation. Okay, pulse excitation is basically any type of excitation that has a finite duration of application. Okay, and then it is zero. Okay, so you have a load that is applied over a finite duration and then it is zero before and after that. So some of the examples would be, okay, a load that is applied like this, okay, or a load, let us say, which is applied like this, or load that is applied like this. Okay, or you could have a different type of load, even this is okay. So any type of load that is applied only over a finite duration of time is called a pulse load. And as you can imagine, if you apply a pulse load, then the system does not actually achieve in a, like in a steady state response. It would always be vibrating, and depending upon whether the system has damping or not, it might come to rest for a damped system, or it might always keep on vibrating. Okay, with the initial conditions provided by this pulse type motion. Okay, so you know there are different type of, you know, several type of pulse type excitation. Okay, what we are going to study first is basically a very common type of pulse excitation, which is rectangular pulse excitation. So for a rectangular pulse excitation, basically I have a rectangular pulse force of magnitude, or sorry, amplitude P naught, applied over a time duration of TD. So now there is a new parameter. Remember, there was a rise time in the previous case that we had discussed. Now that there is a different parameter, it's called TD. Okay, so the load, rectangular pulse, is applied suddenly. It is kept constant till the time duration TD, and then it is released, so that force is zero. Okay, and the system, that we have to find out the response of the system subject to this type of loading. Okay, so I can again go ahead and write down the equation of motion as mu double dot plus ku equal to p of t, where p of t is basically p naught for t smaller than td and equal to 0 for t greater than td. Okay, and in terms of solution, we are going to follow the same procedure that what we have been doing till now. Okay, so first let us do the forced vibration phase. Okay, so for pulse type excitation, we would always divide our response in forced vibration phase, okay, and then the free vibration phase. Okay, and then we will try to obtain the response. So this is basically my forced vibration phase and this is my free vibration phase. Okay, so for this case, let us first obtain the response for forced vibration phase and see what do we get. Okay, so for forced vibration, the equation that I have is this, and we already know the response for, okay, this type of loading. Okay, we had already derived this. This is nothing but a step force. Okay, so the response for this we have already obtained as ut, okay, divided by ust naught. This we had obtained as 1 minus cos omega nt, which can be further written as 1 minus cos 2 pi t by Tm. Okay, and remember this response is valid only for time smaller than the Td, which is the time duration of the pulse. Okay, once this is clear, let us obtain the response for free vibration phase. Okay, so we want to obtain the response for free vibration phase. And for free vibration phase, it is nothing but a free vibration with initial conditions as u of Td and u dot of Td. Okay, that was imparted to the system due to the forced vibration. Okay, so we are going to utilize these initial conditions and find out the response in the free vibration. So ut is nothing but u of Td cos omega n. And remember now, because the initial conditions are at Td, okay, I am going to write this equation like this. Okay, so this is my expression. So I can go ahead and substitute these values, okay, from the expression here, okay, and simplify it to get the final response. Okay, so final response that I get here is actually cos omega n t minus t d minus cos omega n t. Remember, this is the response for t greater than t d. Okay, we can further simplify this and write omega n t equal to 2 pi t divided by t n. Okay, so that would give us this expression here. Okay, 2 pi Td divided by Tn times sine 2 pi T by Tn minus half Td by Tn. Okay, so this is the response that we get for T greater than Td. Okay, and if you look at it, this is nothing but this sine function. Okay, so let us call this sine theta or whatever, and it is multiplied with this coefficient here, which is constant. Okay, so it does not depend on time, it is actually a function of Td by Tn. Okay, so the normalized response, if you look at here, okay, this is actually UAT by UST naught. Okay, this system actually vibrates again at its natural frequency. Okay, and it depends on the ratio Td by Tn. Okay, so like for the case when we had the forced vibration of single degree of freedom system subject to harmonic excitation, there the important parameter was omega by omega n. For a step function with finite rise time or ramp function, the parameter was rise time divided by the time period. Okay, for pulse type motions, we will see the important parameter is actually Td by Tn. Okay, so basically my system, when applied to this, oscillates about its static position, okay, at time period of oscillation of Tn. Okay, and basically we can plot these functions. Okay, we can plot ut by ust naught, okay, for different value of Td by Tn. And I'm going to just bring that figure just to explain you how does it look like. Okay, so if you look at here, okay, depending upon the value of Td by Tn, all right, we have obtained basically different response histories here. Okay, so I have obtained ut by ust naught. Okay, and what I have done here, basically combined the response for ut by ust naught, okay, for free for forced vibration phase and the free vibration phase. Okay, and these are the curves that we get. Okay, and if you look at this carefully, depending upon the value of Td by Tn, okay, the maximum can occur, okay, during the forced phase, okay, or during the free vibration phase, like in these two cases. Okay, And this happens when Td by Tn actually below the value of 1 by 2, okay, like in these cases, then the peak occurs after the value of Td. Okay, let us get into that. Okay, we have these responses. Let us get into that. One thing that we just need to focus here, that when we applied the load P0 over the time duration Td, my system actually starts vibrating about a shifted equilibrium position, which is P0 by K. And when I remove the load, it comes back to its original position, which is U equal to 0. And then it vibrates about this position. Okay. Even though the amplitude is different, the same type of behavior is observed for different value of Td by Tn. Except again for these cases where Td by Tn is actually an integer. When that is the case, then what happens? At the end of the forced vibration phase, we basically get Utd equal to 0 and U dot Td equal to 0. Okay, when Td by Tn is equal to any integer, okay, 1, 2, 3, like that. Okay, so for those cases, okay, after the completion of the forced vibration phase, we do not see any response. Okay, so the system just sits there. Okay, and which can again be interpreted in terms of vibration about equilibrium, that if you are having a system that is vibrating and it comes to equilibrium, and at that point if you have zero velocity and it is in equilibrium, then there won't be any further oscillation because you do not have any velocity or you do not have any initial condition to take the system above that because your force is now zero. Okay, and if your initial conditions are also zero, then there won't be any subsequent motion. So that's why for these cases we obtain behavior which is something like this. Okay, so just to see that how the system behaves subject to different values of Td by Tn. Now let us come back, okay, to finding the maximum response or finding the maximum value of this. Okay, so finding maximum of this, which is nothing but peak dynamic displacement divided by peak static displacement. And as previously described, this is basically the response modification factor. Okay, and this response modification factor, okay, let us obtain that for free vibration phase and forced vibration phase, and overall RD would be maximum, okay, of both. Okay, so let us first obtain RD. Okay, let us see what is the value of RD for forced vibration. Okay, the value of RD was, okay, we had the expression 1 minus cos 2 pi t by Tn. Okay, so this was my expression. So the maximum value of this function is what? It is equal to 2, which occurs at cos 2 pi by t by Tn when it is equal to minus 1. Then I get the maximum response as this one. And for that to occur, okay, so it could be minus 1, minus 2, and so on. Okay, so for those, that condition, let us see what is my T by Tn. Okay, if I substitute it here, I would basically get 2 pi T by Tn as pi, 2 pi, and so on. So my T by Tn is actually Tn by 2, okay, then Tn 3, Tn by 2, and like that. Okay, so basically the maximum response occurs at these durations. Okay, and for at least one maximum to occur, okay, at least one maximum to occur, can you imagine that my T by Tn should at least be greater than Tn by 2? Okay, or that scenario, let us say this is Td here, sorry, not T. Okay, so just correct that. Okay, can you imagine, okay, it would achieve a value of 2 only if Td by Tn is greater than Tn by 2? Okay, so the maximum of this function, the maximum of RD during forced vibration phase would be 2 only if, okay, td by tn is greater than this expression here. Okay, so here maybe I should not write td by tn, just write td here. Okay, that gives me from this expression I become this. Okay, so it has to be greater than half. That means I would have at least one peak of function that I have here. And let us try to understand that graphically as well. So I have this function 1 and this function minus cos 2 pi t by tn. So basically what I'm saying, this is 1 here, okay, and then I'm going to draw minus cos 2 pi td by tn. Let us see how does it look like. Okay, this is a function basically which starts from minus 1, okay, and it goes to a value of, okay, basically something like this. Okay, so for it to achieve a maximum value, if I sum this up, it would look like something like this, shifted by, okay, so this is the first peak that occurs, and that occurs at tn by 2. The second peak occurs at 3n by 3 tn by 2, and so on. Okay, and if I sum this up, this would look like this whole thing would be shifted by 1 upwards. Okay, so it would look like something like this. Okay, this is the response due to the, during the forced vibration phase. Alright, so let us say this is u here. This is the value equal to 2. Okay, and I will say that this is u naught by ust naught. So this is 2 and this is t by tn. Okay, or if you write it as t here, then it would be tn by 2, 3n by 2. So I'm just writing here as half, okay, 3 by 2 and so on. So what I see here, this would achieve a value of 2 only if my td by tn is greater than this value, half. Okay, so I hope you understand this. This is the expression that I have for RD. And this expression can achieve a value up to 2 provided this condition is satisfied. Okay, so cos 2 pi t by tn at least becomes minus 1, minus 2 and like that. Okay, and for that to happen, my td has to be greater than tn by 2. So I will write RD is equal to 2 if my td is greater than tn by 2. So the question comes, well, what happens if td by, okay, if td is smaller than tn by 2? Well, then the maximum response would be during the forced vibration phase, whatever the response is at t equal to td is, okay, which basically we have cos 2 pi td by tn. So it would be just same value and you put the value of td here. So if you look at here, if you substitute td by tn equal to half, then it becomes 2. Okay, but the duration always might not be large enough so that you can have at least one peak during the forced vibration phase. Okay, so I have obtained two expressions, two conditional expressions for the maximum during the forced vibration phase. Let us now go into the free vibration phase. So for free vibration phase, basically, we know that, okay, system undergoes free vibration with initial conditions as ut and ut dot t naught. And I know that if a system is undergoing free vibration with these initial conditions, the amplitude of vibration can always be obtained as using this expression here. Okay, and this is from your free vibration class. Okay, it is. So in that case, it was u0 square. Here, that initial condition is at t equal to td. Okay, so this is here. And you can substitute the value of u of td and u dot of td to obtain the expression for u0. Okay, when you substitute this, you basically get this as 2 of ust naught okay, times sine of, okay, this under root terms is actually a square, so when you take the root it comes as sine of pi td by tn. Okay, so that my rd becomes u0 is t naught, this becomes 2 sine pi t by tn. Okay, all right, so basically what did we see here? Okay, we saw that during the forced vibration phase, okay, depending upon the value of td by tn, okay, the maximum could be 2 or maximum could be this. Okay, if td is smaller than tn by 2, then what happens actually? Okay, then what happens in that case? My response is still increasing. Okay, and this response is basically, okay, so this is, let us say, ut. Okay, this response here is basically your u of td, and then there is some velocity here as well. But the maximum response then occurs during the free vibration phase. Okay, and this is for the case when, let us say, td by tn is here, okay, this is smaller than half here. Okay, if this is greater than half, then this peak would be inside that, okay, for that case. So the response is, so for that case, okay, when td by tn is smaller than half, the maximum occurs during the free vibration phase, and that maximum is actually this value. So if we combine both, okay, what do we actually get? Okay, so if we combine the forced vibration phase and the free vibration phase, I can get one expression for RD, which would be equal to RD equal to UST naught. Okay, this should be equal to 2 sine pi TD by TN. Okay, this is for TD by TN is smaller than half. Okay, so as I said, this is going to cover the peak is going to occur during the free vibration phase if td by tn is smaller than half, and if it is greater than half, then the peak occurs during the forced vibration phase and it is equal to 2. Okay, and you can go ahead and plot these two functions. Okay, so I'm just going to get you the final figure that we have here. Okay, let me just copy this. Okay, so this is basically what I'm saying. Okay, let me write this here. This is forced vibration. Remember, this is for free responses actually. Okay, free responses. For the free response, I have 2 of sine pi td by tn. Okay, forced response is basically when it is smaller than half, td by tn is smaller than half, this value is basically here, which is 1 minus cos pi td, 2 pi td, sorry, 2 pi td by tn. And if it is greater than half, it is 2. So if you take the envelope of both these functions, you get basically the overall maxima. In this one, this is governed by the free response. Okay, and this function is basically 2 sine pi td by tn, and this is basically the value equal to 2. All right, so if you look at it, we are able to obtain the rd as a function of td by tn. Okay, and this is similar when we have obtained rd for a harmonic excitation as function of omega by omega n, or for a ramp loading we had obtained this as function of tr by tn. In this case, we are obtaining as a function of td, which is the load duration divided by the time period of the system. Okay, and this is the plot of peak response, okay, versus some function of t, either directly as a function of tn or some multiple of tn. It is called a response spectra. Okay, So plot of peak response of a single degree of freedom system versus its time period is called response spectra. Okay, and it is a very useful tool that is used by designers in industry. For example, not everybody is going to obtain the differential equation, then go through all those calculations and get the peak response. Okay, if this chart is available, okay, so let us say this chart is given to us for a rectangular pulse loading, then say you have a structure of time period Tn, all right, and you know that a load duration, a rectangular pulse is being applied with a load duration Td, okay, so that you can find out the Td by Tn, okay, and what I'm saying here that you know Tn and you know this load here that is being applied, so basically P0 and Td is known to you, okay, and Tn is also known to you. So if those parameters are known to you, you don't have to solve any differential equation. You can find out the maximum value of U0 as Rd times UST0. Okay, and Rd can be directly obtained here. So let us say for any given value of Td by Tn, you can just go here and then find out what is the value of Td by Tn. Okay, and if you know U0, then you can also find out the equivalent static force in the structure as KU0, assuming that it is represented as a single degree of freedom system. So I'm saying if you can represent this building as a single degree of freedom system, okay, something like this with K and M, then for that case, okay, the equivalent static force is, okay, K times the peak dynamic displacement, which we can further obtain as K times Rd and UST0, which is basically P0 by the stiffness of the structure. So the equivalent static force is basically Rd times the peak static force. Okay. All right. So with this, the discussion on rectangular pulse duration actually concludes. We are going to extend the same procedure to find out the response for other type of pulses in the subsequent classes. Okay. All right. Thank you very much.